About a year ago, I was at a Wall Street Journal conference in LA, and I saw Meg Whitman present Quibi. I always get worried when people raise a lot of money and the product doesn't release till much later. Releasing the first version of the product with a massive marketing campaign almost never works. Today, I want to look at the real reasons Quibi failed. From a startup's perspective, this is a startup. How could they raise almost $2 billion and then shut down less than a year after they launched? This is Raw Startup. I'm the founder of Vivino, the world's largest wine app and community with over 46 million users around the world. We sell wine for hundreds of millions of dollars every year. I'm passionate about startups, and I believe we can learn a lot, both when startups succeed and when they fail. And yes, this is one of the biggest startup failures of all time. Quibi raised $1.75 billion. And looking at my list of the biggest startup failures of all time, Quibi is the second largest startup failure of all time. Interesting fact here is, the former number two is Go.com, and that was a Disney company. Quibi is also funded by Disney. Well done, Disney. So what is Quibi? Quibi is short for Quick Bites. It means they do short form content, 10 minutes or less, for mobile devices. And this might be the key to this. It's mobile only, no TV or any other device. So why did they fail? Here's what Quibi says in the post on the shutdown. Quibi is not succeeding, likely for one of two reasons. Because of the idea itself wasn't strong enough to justify a standalone streaming service, or because of our timing. Very interesting. I'm not sure I agree. Let's dig into the real reasons why I think they failed. And always remember, any startup that fails has hardworking people that have given everything, blood, sweat, and tears for the startup. Thank you very much for trying. It is much better than not trying. Number one, big company people playing startup founders. Let's take a look at the two founders, Meg Whitman and Jeffrey Katzenberg. They are not exactly the traditional hungry startup founders that want to change the world. Meg has an incredible career behind her. There is no doubt that she played a big role in making eBay really, really big. Later, she was also the CEO of Hewlett Packard. Not everything was a success. There are mishaps too. Jeffrey Katzenberg is a long-term and very successful TV and movie executive in Hollywood. Jeffrey did actually co-found DreamWorks, but Meg Whitman did not found eBay or HP. These are big company people playing startup. They are billionaires with very little at stake. I'm sure they invested a lot in Quibi and would argue that they're the biggest loser in all of this. But really, Meg Whitman, how much is your lifestyle going to change because your net worth goes from $5.1 billion to $5 billion? Probably not a lot. I challenge you to please find a company that was started by billionaires and later ended up changing the world, revolutionizing some technology, changing how we do something. I don't know any. Let me know in the comments, please. I could be wrong. Number two, horrible timing. Quibi launched on April 6, 2020, just as the world was hit by a pandemic that left everyone at home. Yes, the coronavirus pandemic did play a role. It is not great to launch a product for on-the-go viewing when everybody's stuck at home, nobody's on the go. The pandemic hit a lot of companies in a very unfair way, but it also accelerated things for many companies. It accelerated some companies into profitability and others shut down faster than they otherwise would. So yes, the pandemic did contribute to the death of Quibi, but if this was a great product done in the right way, Quibi would have survived the pandemic. Number three, no product market fit. This is the obvious one. No product market fit, and yes, this was a major contributor. There's a lot to say about the product, and it's been analyzed by lots of people. Was the content good enough? Was the product good enough? For this particular video, I only want to look at one specific product decision that I think we can learn a lot from. A product decision that led to a lot of bad things down the line and probably killed the product. Whenever we launch a new feature, we should always ask ourselves, how much does it cost to build? How much will it cost to maintain it? And ultimately, are those costs worth it for the user? The feature I'm talking about is Turnstile, what they claimed was the killer feature for Quibi. The feature means you can watch the video in landscape or portrait mode. Sounds cool, but how much does it cost to build, maintain, and is it ultimately worth it? This is where the trouble starts. The cost of this feature is infinitely high. Yes, Quibi had to spend hundreds of millions making content before the launch. Everything made from scratch. On top of that, it was more cumbersome to make the content. Imagine the complexity while you're recording and in the editing room. It also means you can't buy older and less expensive content. You need to pay others to build specifically for your platform. It is expensive and you never stop paying. Any content you make for all of eternity is going to cost more than whatever Netflix or HBO make. So is it really worth it? Hell no. There is no chance this gimmick's going to be worth it. To make matters worse, this also leads to another thing. It means that the killer feature, Turnstile, is only available on mobile. And they decided the entire platform would only be available on mobile. Let me repeat, this is not mobile first, this is mobile only. In my world, that was a horrible decision. Yes, young people today spend an insane amount of time on their mobile phones. But they also watch Game of Thrones on their laptop or even on a good old television. It is a bad idea to take that away from them. Number 4. Too much funding in the wrong order. Startups are built and funded in a specific way. You start small, and when you get bigger, you get more resources. You get to prove a certain milestone, and then you get more funding. Let me show you how traditional funding works for a startup. First, you do an angel round, maybe it's 200,000. Hey, you got an MVP out, fantastic. Then you do a seed round, maybe it's $1 million. Then you do a full launch, and you start getting product market fit. Maybe you're lucky, you do an A round of $10 million. You keep growing, you do a B round of $20 million. And hopefully at some point, you have a commercial success and a profitable company. Let's have a look at how Quibi did this. First round, $1 billion. And then they reach a milestone. They launched a full product. No MVP, no nothing, just full on right away. Hey, that's a nice milestone. Let's raise a second round, $750 million to build more content and market the heck out of this one. Then we reach the last milestone, shut down. It's over. We are only 6 months into the life of this product. You see, this is all wrong. You can't do this in the wrong order. It is not healthy. You will build the wrong product, scale too early, and yes, you just end up making poor product decisions if you have too much money too early. Yes, I'm talking about you, Turnstile. Number 5, no MVP, straight to the full product launch. This is a tricky one. Can you actually do a product like this one with a minimum viable product and then move from there? Some people would argue no. I say yes. We'll look at that in a second. First, the problem with the approach that Quibi picked is that you burn through too much money before the product is ready. You spend hundreds of millions of dollars on content and marketing before the product's ready. And you do marketing for a product that just isn't there. That is money wasted. This leads to investors getting frustrated and ultimately getting impatient and backing out. The pandemic shortened that period even further. So how could you do an MVP here? Instead of raising almost $2 billion, I would raise $50 million, do a lot less content and keep testing it. See if it works. Do people engage with it? Is it really worth it? You keep testing until you get it right. And there's obviously a chance it won't work. That is fine too. The good thing is now you spent $50 million, not $1.7 billion. Number 6. Arrogance. In the 50s, the age of the ad man or the mad man, big companies designed products and put big marketing budgets behind them. Then they would sell. People would buy whatever was advertised. That was the philosophy back then. You just build a product, put lots of money behind it in advertising, and it takes off. That is not how you build products in 2020. This entire Quibi case just reeks of arrogance, of we know what you want arrogance. We are smart, we are rich, we know what you want. We have the best team, the biggest stars, all the money in the world. Yes, even freaking Spielberg is making content for Quibi. Megan Jeffrey, nobody knows what people really want. It takes time and patience to figure that out. All the money in the world, doesn't guarantee success. You need founders with everything at stake, willing to invest blood, sweat, and tears. That's how you build a great startup in 2020. Here's the full list of the real reasons Quibi failed. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you want more content just like this, please consider liking and subscribing. Thank you very much for watching.